Okay. Now we're set. Now you guys have to listen to biochemistry instead of listening to jokes. All right, so I did get the memory of what I was trying to remember last time about the exam I wanted to tell you. So there's two things. One, several of you have asked me about why does it say 102 points on there? Did you change something? And the answer is I didn't change anything. Somebody discovered, I didn't discover it, somebody pointed out to me that there are two question 22s on your exam, which meant that there actually were 122 points on the original exam. So I didn't change anything when I did the regrading. That was just to reflect the fact that was a full 102 points on the exam. The extra credit was on top of that. Some of you asked me, what was the answer to the extra credit question? Because the key didn't have it. The answer was Peter Mitchell was the person who had that very famous hypothesis. The other common question I got, in fact, somebody asked me about it just in here, just before I started, was, you know, wasn't the correct answer that the hydroxyl group was the thing that was removed during the RNR process? And while that was part of the mechanism, the question asked for the atom. And so I'm asking not about the mechanism, but I'm asking what atom disappears from ribose as a result of action of the ribonucleotide reductase. So I apologize, that was confusing. It was not my intention for it to be confusing. But I did use the word atom so as to tell you, hey guys, I'm talking about one thing, not a group. So sorry if that was confusing. But all right. Comment? I'm sorry? Yeah, that's right. But there's another one that's worth three. Yeah, so that evens out. But there are, if you count them up, there are 52 points. I did try to check and make sure that the points were added up correctly, but if you see that your points were not added up correctly on section two, let me know, okay? I did go through and grade essentially every exam, regrade every exam that was there. So, okay. So last time I got started talking about gene expression, and I want to spend a little bit of time today talking about the lac promoter and the lac operon in a little bit more detail. So the lac operon, as I said, is an operon in E. coli, and it has three genes that are encoded within this operon. And as I mentioned about operons before, operons tend to have related genes with related functions on the same unit. And that makes it very efficient for the bacterium because the bacterium can then synthesize one messenger RNA and have all those relevant genes being present. Similarly, when the bacterium turns off the expression, it's a little bit loud, isn't it? When that bacterium turns off the transcription of that gene, then or of that operon, then all the genes are at the same time turned off. And that works very efficiently for the bacteria. All right. Well, the three genes, as I noted, are a beta-galactosidase, and that's for our purposes the most relevant one. Beta-galactosidase catalyzes the breakdown of lactose into galactose and glucose. So that's a really important function, really important thing for the cell to have. The other two genes that are encoded, one's called a permease, and one's called a transacetylase, and they will confuse you a little bit, okay? So I'll warn you about that in advance. The permease is a membrane protein that facilitates the movement of lactose into the cell. Now, what's going to confuse you is the fact that lactose makes its way into the cell, all right, to turn on this operon, right? So if you don't have this permease, how does it get in the cell, blah, blah, all right? Well, it turns out that the cells always have just a little tiny bit of permease present. Always have just a little tiny bit of permease present. So even though I talk about the fact this operon will be either on or off, the reality is that there's a tiny amount of permease present. So if there's lactose present, a little bit of it's going to make it into the cell. And similar to the permease, the transacetylase is also present in the cell at very tiny amounts. Now once this operon gets induced, as we'll see, which is what happens when lactose is present, once the operon gets induced, then all three of these genes are made in great abundance, okay? But just sitting around, there's a little bit of that present at any given time. What does the transacetylase do? Well, the transacetylase has an important function, It converts lactose into something else. Now, this is really confusing, right? Why in the world does this cell that wants this lactose have some of it converted into something else? Well, it turns out that the something else that it gets converted into is called allolactose, okay? Allolactose looks like this. Here's lactose. And if you take the ring from down here and you rearrange it up here, you see that you create this molecule called allolactose. Why do I even talk about allolactose? Well, allolactose turns out to be the inducer of the lac operon. Now I need to tell you what an inducer is. What is an inducer? An inducer is a molecule that, when present, causes transcription of the operon to occur. It's a molecule that, when present, causes transcription of the operon to occur. So, cell encounters some lactose. Some of that lactose makes it into the cell. Some of that lactose gets converted into allolactose, and the cell goes, voila, we have lactose. Let's start making this operon. Okay, it is a little confusing set of steps. I'll show you how that happens, but I want you to know what happens before I show you how that happens. Okay, so the what is lactose presence results in movement into the cell, production of allolactose, and then induction of transcription of the lac operon. So how does that happen? Okay, well, here's what happens. Here is the DNA encoding the lac operon, okay? And it's also encoding upstream of the lac operon something called the lac repressor. Now, the lac repressor, as I mentioned last time, is a protein that can bind to the operator. The operator is the region right next to the minus 10 sequence where the RNA polymerase wants to bind, okay? The lac repressor binds to that operator, and when it binds to the operator, it prevents RNA polymerase from being able to bind. That's why it's called the repressor. So we see that right here. Here's the repressor. This protein is encoded by this gene up here. So note that the lac repressor coding region is not part of the lac operon. It's coded right next to it. Okay? It's not a part of it. But its coding region is immediately adjacent to the operon. The lac repressor is always made by the cell. The cell is always making the lac repressor. It's an important point. Okay? It doesn't make a lot of it because it doesn't need a lot of it. It only needs enough to cover up the operator, which is one. Typically, it'll have a little bit more than one, but it doesn't have very much of this lac repressor floating around the cell. When the lac repressor, as I say, binds to the operator, which is shown by the O site, the O sequence here, then the RNA polymerase cannot bind. Well, I just said that the lac repressor is always being made, so why isn't the operon always off? Why does transcription of the operon ever occur? Why doesn't this repressor just stop at all? Well, it turns out that the repressor has a binding site on it for a molecule known as the inducer. And the inducer is allolactose. So the repressor can bind allolactose. What happens when the repressor binds allolactose? Well, you can see what happens. It no longer binds to the operator. Now, this is a beautiful and simple system. When lactose is present, allolactose will be made. Allolactose will bind to the repressor. The repressor itself will no longer be able to bind to the operator. And now the promoter region is completely open for RNA polymerase to bind and start transcription. In other words, lactose has just told the cell, I'm present, make some enzymes to break me down. Okay? And when we look at what are called inducible promoters, which is what this is, we're inducing it to form, Inducible promoters are being made in response to changes in environmental conditions. This environmental condition change is lactose is present. Okay? Everybody with me? Questions about that? Okay. Well, that's the simple part of it, and there's really nothing complicated about the system. There's another component to the system that's even more clever and cool, if you will. Okay. If I look at any cell, virtually any cell on the face of the earth prefers to break down glucose. Okay? If glucose is present, the cell says, hey, I've got glycolysis going, I don't have to mess with anything else, I break it down. So what happens if the cell has glucose and the cell has lactose? Will the cell do this? Okay. Well, it turns out that yes, the cell will do this to some extent. But there's a cool feature of the lac promoter, and the cool feature is going to surprise you. The cool feature of the lac promoter is it's not a very good promoter. It's not a very good promoter. So why in the world, this is an important promoter, why in the world does this cell have this promoter that's not very good to make these genes that's going to that break down lactose and help keep the cell alive? Well, the answer to that question lies in this other region ahead of the promoter. That was the cap region. The cap region, I told you, was bound by a protein called the catabolite activating protein, or CAP. Okay? CAP can bind to the cap site, and when CAP binds to the cap site, it favors the binding of RNA polymerase at the promoter. In other words, it makes the promoter sequence be a much better promoter, meaning more transcription occurs. So cap helps the RNA polymerase to bind. Okay. So what happens then? What controls the binding of cap? Well, that is rooted in the conundrum I just posed for you. What if glucose is present, and what if lactose is present? If glucose is present, is the cell at high energy level or low energy level? If glucose is present, will the cell be at a high energy level or a low energy level? High. It's got plenty of energy, right? At high energy, okay, the cell does not make a molecule called cyclic AMP. You've seen cyclic AMP in our cells. It's also used in other cells. However, when the cell is running out of energy, one of the emergency signs is the synthesis of cyclic AMP, C-A-M-P. Not AMP, C-A-M-P. Okay? And guess what C-A-M-P binds to? Cap. Okay? And the only time that cap binds to the cap site on the DNA is when it's bound to cyclic AMP. So I'm going to run through this whole thing for you. Okay? Let's start with the cap, and I'll finish with the promoter. With the repressor, I'm sorry. Okay. So the cell is running out of energy. The cell makes cap. I'm sorry, makes cyclic AMP. I'm screwing it up. Makes cyclic AMP. Cyclic AMP binds to cap. Cap binds to the cap site. That favors the binding of RNA polymerase. And transcription starts when? When lactose is present, right? What if lactose is not present? Well, if lactose is not present, and cyclic AMP is present, what's going to happen? Well, cap's going to bind over here. Lac repressor is going to bind over here. Who's going to win? Who do you suppose is going to win? The repressor is going to win because it's blocking the site for the RNA polymerase to bind. So this is beautifully set up. The only time that the lac operon will be synthesized in any significant amount is when energy is low, meaning no glucose, and when lactose is present. The cell is thus not wasting energy on things that it doesn't need. If energy is low and there's no lactose, you sure don't want to be wasting energy making this operon, right? On the other hand, if energy is low and you have lactose, by golly, this is my lifesaver. Okay? On the repressor side of stuff, the only time that the repressor is off of the operator is when lactose is present, because that's when allolactose is made. If there's no lactose present, the repressor will be bound to the repressor site, the O site, and consequently, no transcription will occur. So it's a really cool and simple system to ensure that only transcription is the only transcription is occurring when the cell needs those transcripts. Okay, questions about that? Everybody looks dazed. Okay, let's turn our attention away from that and talk about another system. Oh, actually, I'm going to show you CAP. There's CAP. There's the protein that binds. There's the CAP binding site in the DNA shown in orange. And there is cyclic AMP embedded in there. The only time that that CAP binds to the CAP site is when cyclic AMP is bound to it. Okay, and let's see. This simply shows what I was just describing. CAP bound to cyclic AMP facilitates the binding of the RNA polymerase when the repressor is off of the operator. All right, well, there's a related system that called the trip operon. And in fact, what I'm going to show you here for the trip operon is true for several operons in E. coli involved in the synthesis of amino acids. The synthesis of amino acids typically takes several different enzymes, and they're organized in operons so that the cell can synthesize all of the needed enzymes in one transcript. Again, if the cell has plenty of tryptophan, it doesn't want to be wasting energy making these enzymes to synthesize tryptophan. If the cell is short on tryptophan, then the cell wants to be transcribing these genes necessary to make tryptophan. So it's a very simple scheme, again, in terms of what the cell's needs are. And the regulation of it is similar, but it's also distinctive. The similarity relates to the repressor. If you look at the repressor, okay, there's something called the TERP repressor. All right, TERP is tryptophan, the tryptophan repressor. The tryptophan repressor binds to an operator site that overlaps with the promoter, just like we saw in the lac operon. And binding of the repressor, okay, inhibits the operon. Inhibits transcription of the operon. All right? Now, when the cell has tryptophan, it doesn't want to be making these genes. So the TRP repressor only binds to the operator when tryptophan is abundant, because that's tryptophan binds to the repressor and turns off transcription. So it's backwards from the lac operon, but the same idea is occurring. A repressor is binding to the operator and turning off transcription of the entire operon. When tryptophan becomes low, then the repressor comes off and transcription of the gene proceeds. Okay? Well, there's another level of control of the tryptophan operon, and it's kind of intriguing. It's called attenuation. I've got two schemes to show you. I'm going to show you this one first because I think it's actually a little better. Okay? What is attenuation? So the tryptophan, repressor system that I showed you on the last slide works about 75% of the time. It doesn't give the complete control of the operon. The complete control of the operon also requires the system I'm going to show you here. The system I'm going to show you here doesn't have anything to do with the initiation of transcription. It has to do with premature termination of the transcription as a control mechanism. OK? Okay? So, what happens? Well, remember that we're in bacteria. And bacteria have transcription and translation occurring at the same time in the same place. So translation of a messenger RNA will begin as soon as it starts coming out of, this is actually a ribosome here, by the way, as soon as it comes out of the RNA polymerase. Here's the RNA polymerase, all right? So once that tail starts coming out of the RNA polymerase, once the ribosome says, oh, look, there's an AUG, and there's a Shine-Dalgarno sequence, and we can translate it, it will grab a hold of the 5' end of the messenger RNA and start translating it. And that's what's happening here. So we see transcription occurring. Look down here at first. We see transcription occurring at the same time as translation is following it. Okay? Now, what attenuation does, it's another sensing mechanism that the cell uses to determine is there abundant or not sufficiently abundant tryptophan. And this system also helps determine whether or not that operon will be, the entire operon will be transcribed. You can see that initiation of transcription has occurred. The transcript has started to be made. Okay. So what's happening here? So the RNA polymerase starts the 5' end, it's got the AUG, the ribosome comes along and starts translating. The ribosome translates and it gets to there. You'll see I've labeled four regions on here. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. It turns out that these regions can form internal base pairs with themselves, like you've seen with other RNAs. Okay? This structure may look familiar. Remember the factor-independent transcriptional termination? Didn't require Rho, but it formed that hairpin that lifted the butt end of the polymerase up and everything fell off? Well, guess what that is? That's a terminator. Why do we see a terminator on the top and we don't see a terminator on the bottom? Okay? Well, let's focus on the top for the moment. Yes, question? No. So this process that I'm showing you here actually occurs with several amino acid operons. It occurs with valine, I think with leucine, about 5 or 6 actually. Same exact scheme. Okay, so attenuation, learning it here, is useful for all of the, or not all, but for several of the other amino acid operons. Okay, so here's the RNA polymerase. It's been going along, and this terminator sequence gets hit, and the terminator sequence says, okay, transcription's over. Stop making what would otherwise be a very long messenger RNA with several other genes on it. This guy has stopped. Why did this guy stop? And this guy down here has not stopped. There's a difference between the two. This guy in the bottom is going to make the entire tryptophan operon. Well, let's think about this. Under what conditions does the cell want to make the entire tryptophan operon? High tryptophan or low tryptophan? Low. So we know that the bottom must have low conditions of tryptophan, whereas the top must have abundant tryptophan. If this system makes any sense, right? And it does. Okay? It does make sense. All right, so let's get back to this question. Well, if we look at the top, what's happened? Translation is moving along. The ribosome is moving along the messenger RNA. And you can see the ribosome has gone and it's covered up regions 1 and 2, allowing regions 3 and 4 to form this base pair that makes the terminator. Why doesn't it get to 2 down here? The reason it doesn't get to 2 is that this first tiny polypeptide that's made at the 5' end of this messenger RNA is called a leader sequence. It's an important name, a leader sequence. And the leader sequence is a region of about 10, 15 amino acids, and the protein doesn't do a damn thing. But the protein has within it multiple regions where tryptophan is required as an amino acid. Okay? If the tryptophan in a cell is abundant, what happens? The ribosome says, I just go scooting through it, no problem. it quickly gets and covers region 2. When it covers region 2, region 2 can't pair with region 3, so region 3 instead pairs with region 4, and we get a terminator. When tryptophan is low, the ribosome gets to that first tryptophan, and what does it do? It waits, and it waits, and it waits for a tRNA with tryptophan to come in. Well, tryptophan's never completely absent. It's low, but it's not completely absent. The ribosome is pausing. And because it's pausing, it's covering up region 1, but it's not covering up region 2. Region 2 is completely free to bind to region 3. And if region 3 is bound to region 2, it can't also bind to region 4. Therefore, no terminator appears. And the RNA polymerase doesn't get stopped. It now goes and it makes the entire operon. It's a really cool system. And it's not a fluke. As I said, there are several operons for amino acid synthesis in E. coli that operate exactly the same way. Would this work in eukaryotic cells? It would not. Why would it not? Because this requires transcription and translation. Was that your answer? Okay. I didn't see your hand. I heard a whistle. I didn't see your hand until the last minute. Because this requires transcription and translation at the same place at the same time. This relies on translation to help tell if there's enough tryptophan or not. In a eukaryotic cell, translation is occurring out in the cytoplasm, so there wouldn't be a possibility of terminating transcription early. Okay? That's how attenuation works. It's pretty cool. Questions about that? Usually there are questions. Was I so clear, or you were so sleepy that... So sleepy. Yes? It's a good question. Why is region 3 more apt to bind to region 2 than region 4? I won't say that it's more apt to, but it means that if we have a bunch of these that are being made, chances are you're going to have more of them that will pair with 2 than you do when the ribosome is moving fast. Therefore, more transcripts will escape and be made full length. Okay? Good question. These are the two possible structures. Here's one pair. It turns out 1 and 2 can actually pair as well, but since the ribosome is sliding along there, they get gobbled up. One second. And then here's 2 paired to 3, and you can see 1 is free, and you see 4 is free. Run. I'm not sure I understood the question, Ron. Yes. So that's right. So when 3 and 4 do not pair, that's not a terminator. Termination does not happen. Transcription continues, and the entire operon gets made. That's the key to the whole thing. Yeah. Okay? It is perfect. It's pretty cool. Because of this, combined with the tryptophan repressor that I showed you earlier, the cell has exquisite control over when to make the proteins that are coded in that operon. Pretty cool. Yes? Say it again. So 3 and 4 will not pair. Let me go back to the thing. So 3 and 4 will not pair when 2 pairs with 3. And so 2 pairs with 3 when the ribosome pauses, because 2 is available to pair with 3. So I'm not sure I understand the question. So if there's no hairpin at 3 and 4, then the entire operon will be synthesized. No, it's not chance at all, because the only thing that stops it is this terminator. So if this terminator doesn't form, then the RNA polymerase is going to continue along its way. This is the on-off switch for whether the RNA polymerase stops here or not. So if it stops here, okay, what's made is a very short messenger RNA. Only this tiny polypeptide that I described is translated, and the cell isn't wasting energy, or not much energy, not as much energy as if it did the whole thing. Yes, it is wasting some energy in doing this, okay, but it's not wasting the energy of the entire operon. Am I answering your question? I hope so. Okay. Okay, so attenuation is pretty cool. All right, I want to talk about another phenomenon found mostly in bacterial cells. There's at least one case where it's known to occur in eukaryotic cells, but it's mostly found in bacterial cells. And these are called ribose switches. And ribose switches are pretty easy to understand. Okay, ribose switches rely on the fact that RNAs have some secondary and tertiary structure. Remember how the tRNA bound over into that folded structure? Okay? This is the equivalent of what a protein would have of tertiary structure. So when RNAs can have folded structures like proteins do, it means that they have essentially binding sites for molecules. Okay? And those binding sites for molecules can affect the shapes of messenger RNAs that are being made. So here's an example where I've got a molecule, either a molecule being absent or a molecule being present. Okay? The molecule being absent means that this structure that you see on the left, which could bind it, has a different structure than if it actually does bind it. All right? On the left, structure without it. On the right, structure with it. So these structures are slightly different, just like hemoglobin was slightly different when you put oxygen on it compared to not putting oxygen on it. Or when an allosteric protein bound to its molecule and changed from R to T or T to R, okay? The RNA is changing shape as a result of that, and one of the shape changes, in this case, we've got is making a terminator. This can't make a terminator. This can make a terminator. Very simple. So the presence or absence of the molecule, in this case, determines whether or not a terminator is made to stop the transcription, or no terminator is made, called an anti-terminator, to allow transcription. Okay? These things are called riboswitches. The relevant part of its binding is called the aptamer domain. And the region adjacent to it is called a switching sequence. And you can see the switching sequence is actually changing from here over to here. So it's the switching sequence that's essentially giving the signal to what's going to happen next. Okay? There are other things that can happen besides this. I'm using anti-termination and termination as an example because it's one we've gone through in class. Okay? So riboswitches are very simple schemes involving RNA tertiary structure that control transcription of a bigger RNA. Questions on that? Okay. And there is a riboswitch bound to lysine. Lysine is one amino acid who can control its own, the synthesis of operon related to it, through a riboswitch. And I just show you that so you can see what it looks like. Okay, well, let's turn our attention to eukaryotes, where things do get a lot more complicated. And I'll try to keep it as simple as I can, but it is a lot more complexity that's there. Okay, as we've noted before, we have to deal with chromatin. Chromatin is DNA wrapped with protein. And all that wrapping of DNA with protein is an important consideration. Transcription factors, which are proteins that recognize specific sequences in DNA and affect transcription, have to be able to find those sequences in DNA. If the DNA is all wrapped up with histones, they're not going to be nearly as accessible or visible to transcription factors as if they're loose. Okay? So that's that looseness is a very important consideration in the control of transcription of eukaryotic genes. There are also molecules I mentioned earlier, are sequences called enhancers. And enhancers are, as I've briefly mentioned when I talked about eukaryotic transcription before, are sequences that are sort of like promoter sequences, except for they're located, in some cases, thousands of base pairs away from the transcriptional start site. And we'll see a little bit about how they work as I talk about this. Okay. Well, let's think about chromatin. Chromatin, we can look at it several levels. And what I've done with this figure is started with a chromosome, which is the biggest macromolecular structure we can see relevant to DNA in a cell, on the left. And as we go sequentially from left to right, we're zooming in further and further and further. We're looking at smaller and smaller regions. And as we do this, I only show you this to help you to get a better understanding about the packing that's actually done of the DNA by these proteins. This very tightly packed structure right here looks like, oh, there's DNA right there, but in fact that DNA is still DNA wrapped with proteins, DNA wrapped with proteins. We don't even begin to see the proteins until we get down to this level here, okay? And we see that when we get to this level here where we start to see the individual proteins that are there, we see that they're arranged in arrays that are very, very tightly packed. Only when we loosen those arrays do we see the beads on a string that I've mentioned briefly, and those beads on a string contain individual nucleosomes where we have the histones wrapped with DNA wrapped around them. This is an enlargement of a nucleosome. So the modeling or the remodeling of the chromatin is very, very critical for us to understand. Very critical for us to understand, yes. So let's think about, let's think about histones. I mentioned them briefly before, okay? There are four of them in a nucleosome, and they're each present in two copies, making what's called an octamer. The histones are known as H2A, H2B, H3, and H4. H2A and H2B form a dimer. H3 and H4 form a dimer. Two dimers of each come together to make a histone octamer. Okay? Histones are very positively charged at physiological pH. They contain a lot of lysine, and they contain a lot of arginine. That positive charge is really important for them having DNA wrapped around them because DNA is negatively charged. And several of the modifications that we will see that will happen affect the charge of those lysines and arginines and consequently affect the tightness with which DNA wraps around the histones. Okay? Another feature to note, and it's a little hard to see on this figure, I'll show you another figure in a second, are that sticking out of this wrapped structure are little tiny tails coming off of each histone. Those little tails play some very important roles in the control of transcription. Very, very important roles in the control of transcription. Okay? You know what a nucleosome is by now, okay? Two copies of each of four histone proteins. They're the four histone proteins. As I think I mentioned in class before, those four histone proteins are almost absolutely conserved in sequence going from yeast all the way to humans. It says that sequence is really, really important for the function that they perform. You screw up with the sequence too much and you no longer are able to wrap your DNA, and if you can't wrap your DNA or control your DNA, you're in trouble. This figure also shows the sort of sealing function of histone H1. That's the fifth histone. And the fifth histone, you notice, is not part of the octamer core, but instead is on the outside, sort of holding this structure together. Okay. You guys need to wake up here. histones, tiny histones, wrap up eukaryotic DNA. Using lysine side chains, they arrange a chromatin array. With them, DNAs of 7 feet fit inside the nucleus so sweet. When you use the histones, you have to deal with condensation and its ablation inside your chromosomes. Okay, hopefully you're awake now. Okay. As I said, histones are rich in basic amino acids, okay? Arginines, lysines in particular. That makes them very positively charged, and that positive charge is critical, okay? The chemical alterations that happen to histones are not absolutely, but mostly affecting those negative charges, okay? And so things that modify histones have very big effects on how tightly the DNA is wrapped around the histones. Notice I showed you that several levels of structure. Remember the array of those nucleosomes that I showed you? What if you started loosening that array and you got things to the point of having beads on a string instead of having that array? What you would have when you had beads on a string is you would have open sequences of DNA that a transcription system could bind to. Whereas if I have that array of those nucleosomes all tightly packed together, all right, the transcription factors that affect transcription cannot get into those sequences and control gene expression. Okay. This is the nucleosome in a little finer detail with the octamer core shown in here. And now you can see those tails that I mentioned earlier that are sticking out. These tails sticking out really play a very important role, as we will see. Okay. So one of the modifications I want to talk about with respect to histones actually relates to acetylation. So acetylation, as its name implies, is adding of an acetyl group to something. Well, in terms of what's happening in the histones, acetylation results in putting on acetyl groups onto lysines. Well, lysine, of course, is a positively charged amino acid. If I put an acetyl group on it, I reduce its positivity. That is, it's less positive. Well, if it's less positive, it's going to less tightly bind to the DNA that's negatively charged. So what have I started to do? I have started to loosen the hold that the DNA has on the histones. Okay? Loosens the interaction with the histones and facilitates what we call remodeling or restructuring of the chromatin. We do enough of this, we convert chromatin from one form into another form, as we will see. Okay? So here's a histone tail, here's a modification to it, and you can see here's the array over here, and here are the beads on the string over here. We've loosened this guy up. Yes, sir. You're right. It loosens the effect of the negative charge on the DNA, but you're right. That should say positive charge for the lysine. Thank you. Thank you. Yes. Okay. Okay. Here are some of the modifications that actually happen to the histones. Now, we're not going to memorize this or anything, okay? But I show you this. This actually relates to methylation, which is another thing that can happen to tails of histones, okay? Methylation involves putting on a methyl group. Well, it turns out that the amine end of a lysine tail can accept three methyl groups. Three methyl groups, okay? We can put three different methyls on there by replacing hydrogens. And when we do that, we see something interesting that happens. Okay? Well, let me tell you what this table says first. So we're looking at different histones. H3 relates to histone H3. H4 is shown over here, and there's also H2, okay? The letters, the other letters there, H3K4, K stands for lysine, so that stands for H3 at position 4, histone 3, the lysine at position 4. So we're talking about a specific amino acid and its methylation. If we put one methyl group on at this position, we see activation. If we put two methyl groups on at that same position, we see activation. Let's go over to the lysine at position 9. Put one methyl group on, we get activation. Put two methyl groups on, we get repression. Three methyl groups, repression, acetylation, activation. This is complicated. I don't need to tell you that. It's complicated. I'm almost out of time, so I'm not going to talk about that complication today. I'll talk about it next time. But I do have an additional song for you today to finish up translation. It's called Good Protein Synthesis. Amino acids cannot join by themselves together. They require ribosomes to create the tether. All the protein chains get made according to instruction, carried by mRNA in peptide bond construction. Small subunits starts it all with initiation, pairing up two RNAs at the docking station. Scheindel-Garnaut's complement in the 16S's lined the AUG up so synthesis commences. Elongation happens in ribosomic insides where our RNA creates bonds for polypeptides. These depart the ribosome, passing right straight through it in the tiny channels there of the large subunit. Finally, when the sequence of one of these stop codons parks itself in the A site, synthesis can't go on. P site RNA lets go of what it was holding, so the polypeptide can't get on with its folding. All right, thank you, guys.